partisan nonsense. I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back. Gentleman from Michigan reserves. Gentleman from Texas.
Mr. Speaker, I yield 1 minute to the former mayor of Manchester, New Hampshire, who understands how badly this bill has hurt his family and community, Mr. Ginta.
Gentleman from New Hampshire is recognized for 1 minute.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you very much to Chairman Brady and to Chairman Price for putting this piece of legislation together. I rise in support today of H.R. 3762, the Restoring Americans Health Care Freedom Reconciliation Act, which includes the repeal of components of the most harmful provisions of Obamacare, at the same time sharing bipartisan support for each component of this legislation, bipartisan support. I've worked hard with members across the aisle to make sure that provisions that are hurting families in Manchester, in Portsmouth, in Conway, in all parts of New Hampshire, to ensure their voices are heard. One of the important provisions in this bill is the full repeal of Obamacare's 40% tax on health care benefits, commonly referred to as the Cadillac tax. While this tax is set to take effect in 2018, employers of all sizes are already restructuring plans, cutting benefits to avoid the costly tax. This excise tax will impact an estimated 12 million middle-class Americans who will pay an additional $1,000 annually as a result of this tax. They work for big businesses, small businesses, nonprofits, colleges, small municipalities. They need help. They need our support.
Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to yield another 30 seconds.
Gentleman's recognized for an additional 30 seconds.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As I introduce the repeal of the Cadillac tax in its entirety, I am pleased to see that repeal language included in the bill we're debating today. On top of all the burdens of Obamacare that have already been placed on hardworking Americans and all the rules and regulations Americans' businesses are faced with, this tax will make it just that much more difficult for employers to provide affordable health care benefits to their employees. So I urge my colleagues, please, join the bipartisan fight to support middle-class families and support the repeal of this tax. Thank you, and I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Gentleman from Texas reserves. The gentleman from Michigan.
You ready? Okay, how much time do you need? All right. I yield a minute and a half to the gentleman from New Jersey, a very vigorous member of our committee, Mr. Pasquale.
Gentleman from New Jersey is recognized for a minute and a half.
Thank you, Ranking Member. Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Speaker, I've heard now twice this morning the term bipartisan. Many of my brothers and sisters on the other side wouldn't know bipartisan if it hit you in the head. I mean, just throw this term out there like, you know, if you have one or two on this side of the aisle, it's bipartisan. Technically, you're absolutely right. We should be crafting a long-term funding measure, Mr. Speaker, replacing the damaging sequester cuts that have hurt our economy. And we're both responsible, both sides of the aisle, for that sequester. I don't point any fingers. And we also got to raise the debt ceiling. I mean, we talk about our budgets at home. Why don't we do the same thing in the federal government? I was taught when I grew up, pay your bills. Pay your bills. That's as important as balancing the budget at home. This bill leaves intact automatic budget cuts, which have threatened hundreds of thousands of jobs and cut vital services for children, for seniors, for people with mental illness, and our men and women in uniform. These harmful cuts have cut funding for thousands of first responders in our communities.
Additional 30 seconds.
Gentleman's recognized for an additional 30 seconds.
They've cut vital services for children, our first responders. They've eliminated jobs for 30,000 teachers, 30,000. Cut after school programs for nearly 1.2 million kids. Eliminated more than 40 million meals for the sick and homebound seniors. Bipartisan, this is bipartisan. We should replace these harmful cuts and support vital services in our community. Instead, We're talking about holding your government hostage in exchange for decimating the Affordable Care Act. Enough is enough. Remember when a guy threw the window up in that movie Network? We're not going to take it anymore. The Republican budget would result in 16 million fewer Americans having health insurance and 20% increase in insurance premiums. A vote for this bill is a vote against those 16 million Americans. A vote for this bill is a vote for higher premiums. On top of that, this budget doesn't balance. In 2025, it goes through the sky.
Gentlemen's time
not
is expired.
Not a balanced budget. This is a fake. Why don't we sit down and come up with a mutual plan?
Gentlemen's time is expired.
Of, quote unquote, a bipartisan fraud.
The gentleman's time is expired.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Gentleman from Michigan reserves. The gentleman from Texas is recognized.
Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to yield a minute and a half to the gentleman from Kentucky who knows the failures of the Affordable Care Act in his state, Mr. Barr.
Gentleman from Kentucky is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise today in support of H.R. 3762, the Restoring Americans Healthcare Freedom Reconciliation Act. Too many Americans across the country are victims of Obamacare's many broken promises. We all remember the chaos that ensued when the law was first rolled out, a billion-dollar website that didn't work, millions of Americans losing their insurance and being forced to find a new plan, often at higher cost. Now, hundreds of thousands of Americans, including at least 51,000 Kentuckians, are once again losing their health insurance because of the failure of Obamacare healthcare cooperatives. In his State of the Union address, President Obama cited Kentucky as an example of Obamacare working in a red state. But as we learned last week, Obamacare does not work in Kentucky. In the past 2 weeks, Obamacare co-ops have failed in my home state of Kentucky, Tennessee, Colorado, Oregon, and South Carolina. Co-ops have failed in Nevada, Iowa, Nebraska, New York, and Louisiana. And these failures were entirely predictable because the model was not sustainable. The Kentucky co-op lost nearly 60 cents for every premium dollar it collected. Now, hardworking taxpayers will be stuck with a bill for hundreds of millions of dollars that will never be paid back. Combined with low enrollment numbers, the result of these failures will ultimately be borne on the American people. Consolidation in the healthcare market, fewer choices for consumers, and higher healthcare costs for the American people. This is not the reform we were promised. The bill we are debating today would repeal the most harmful mandates and taxes imposed by the law. It reduces the deficit by $130 billion,
Mr. Speaker,
it gives us an opportunity to put a bill on the president's desk that would make life easier for the American people. I encourage all my colleagues to join me in supporting this bill. I yield back.
Gentleman's
Thank
time
you.
Has expired. Gentleman from Texas reserves.
Speaker,
gentleman from
time,
Michigan.
How much time of our 15 minutes are left?
Gentleman has 5 minutes remaining.
5 minutes. It's now my real pleasure to yield a minute and a half at least to the gentleman from New York, Mr. Crowley.
Gentleman from New York is recognized for a minute and a half.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I thank the gentleman from Michigan for yielding me this time. Mr. Speaker, I rise in opposition to this latest attempt to repeal the Affordable Care Act and the benefits it has brought to millions of Americans. While this is the 61st vote this House has taken to undermine health care, my colleagues on the other side of the aisle claim that somehow this time is different. That's because this is dressed up in a process called reconciliation. But this isn't reconciliation, this is procrastination. This is a desperate attempt to avoid working on the real issues facing America today. I get it. Governing's hard. It's difficult. But that's not an excuse for giving up on your responsibilities and instead pursuing yet another repeal bill. But that's their plan, their only agenda for America. Country is days away from defaulting on our debt. Time to repeal the Affordable Care Act. Roads and bridges are falling apart. Maybe repealing the Affordable Care Act will help us. Seniors on Medicare are about to see their premiums skyrocket. Forget fixing the problem. Let's repeal the Affordable Care Act. They must think it's a better strategy than the previous 60 votes if they wrap it up in a bow and slap a fancy name on it. Actually, It's odd they call this reconciliation.
Gentleman's recognized for 30 seconds.
Republicans aren't reconciling with us to work in a bipartisan way. They're not reconciling themselves to the fact that the Affordable Care Act is the law of the land and that it is helping people access quality, affordable health care insurance. And they're certainly not fooling anyone with what their true intentions are. You're not. Frankly, the only thing they're doing is wasting time. I've had enough, and I know the American people have had enough too, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back. The gentleman from Michigan reserves. The gentleman from Texas is recognized.
Mr. Speaker, I am very pleased to yield 2 minutes to a member of Congress who is a health care provider herself, a nurse, a key leader of the health care subcommittee, the gentlelady from Tennessee, Ms. Black.
Gentlelady from Tennessee is recognized for 2 minutes.
I thank the chairman and also Chairman Price for bringing this bill to the floor. Mr. Speaker, I rise today in strong support of today's budget reconciliation to address the heinous abuse of life at Planned Parenthood. To date, we have seen 10 undercover videos implicating the abortion giant in the trafficking of unborn babies' tissue and organs. Planned Parenthood and their enablers could not defend the conversations on these tapes, which many here in Washington still have not watched. So they try to discredit the source. The House Minority Leader even said, and I quote, "I don't stipulate that these videos are real," close quote. Well, Mr. Speaker, that is my colleague's prerogative, but the facts, and specifically this forensic report, say differently. Since these revelations were uncovered, the House has voted twice now to cut federal funding to Planned Parenthood and reallocate those dollars to other providers that better serve women and families. But Senate Democrats repeatedly blocked these solutions. In fact, only two senators from the minority party could muster the compassion to vote for this proposal. I refuse to let the callousness and the obstructionism of a select few stop this worthwhile effort. That is why I'm voting today for the reconciliation bill to freeze Medicaid funding to Planned Parenthood. This is our best opportunity to date to put the bill on the president's desk and show the American people where his priorities lie. Mr. Speaker, we face many challenges in Washington today, but nothing could be more important than how we treat an innocent human life. This is a fight worth having, and it's a fight I will continue to have to the very end. I urge a yes vote on the budget reconciliation bill, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentlelady yields back. The gentleman from Texas reserves. Gentleman from Michigan.
I now yield a minute and a half to the distinguished gentlelady from California, Ms. Lee, who's a member of the Budget and Appropriations Committee.
Gentlelady from California is recognized for a minute and a half.
Thank you very much. Let me thank our ranking member for yielding and for your tremendous leadership on so many issues. Mr. Speaker, I rise in opposition to H.R. 3762, the so-called Restoring Americans Health Care Freedom Reconciliation Act. This bill would attack women's health and the Affordable Care Act once again. This bill would defund Planned Parenthood for 1 year, leaving millions of women across the country without access to critical health care services. It would also prevent individuals or organizations that provide comprehensive reproductive health care services from treating women enrolled in Medicaid, stripping women of their fundamental right to choose their own health care provider, and leaving thousands of women out in the cold. Now, let's be clear. Family planning services are critical to reducing unintended pregnancies, and they make economic sense also. For every $1 spent on family planning services, we save more than $7 in other costs. Mr. Speaker, denying access to health care providers such as Planned Parenthood and other safety net providers will hurt women who need these services the most, low-income women and women of color. It's past time to stop these ideological attacks on women's right to health care. Instead of continuing with these callous attacks and cuts, we should work to replace the damaging sequester and get a responsible long-term budget deal. This bill reconciles nothing. It is divisive, it's misguided, and it's dangerous. I urge a no vote. I thank you and yield back the balance of my time.
Gentlelady yields back. The gentleman from Michigan reserves. The gentleman from Texas.
Yes, Mr. Speaker, I'm proud to yield 2 minutes to the Majority Whip of the U.S. House, a strong leader against the Affordable Care Act and for defunding Planned Parenthood. The gentleman from Louisiana, Mr. Scalise.
Gentleman from Louisiana is recognized for 2 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I thank the gentleman from Texas for yielding. I want to thank my colleague, the gentleman from Georgia, for his leadership on bringing this reconciliation bill to the floor. And Mr. Speaker, as we've fought for years to defeat the president's health care law and the many destructive components to that law that are playing out all across the country, we've got one more opportunity, Mr. Speaker, to send a bill to the president, but this time not just to send a bill to the Senate that actually goes after and guts the president's health care law, but also a bill that now with 51 votes in the Senate will have the opportunity to get to the president's desk. And the bill not only repeals the employer mandate, repeals the individual mandate, laws that are crushing jobs across the country, killing middle class jobs. The biggest reason when you talk to small business owners why they can't hire more people, why they're forced by this law to lower the number of working hours of people across the country down below 30 hours is because of these mandates in the law that are crushing American jobs. Why not put that bill on the president's desk? Why not also tell these people that are taking taxpayer money and providing abortion services that you can't do it anymore? If you want to provide women's health care, there's funding for you, but you can't use taxpayer money to provide abortions. That's in this bill. Can get to the president's desk. But even more than that, it goes further. And we start cutting taxes that are killing jobs in this bill. The medical device tax that's shipping jobs to foreign countries. Let's cut those taxes. And if the Senate wants to go further under their arcane rules, they'll have that opportunity. And we'd support those changes as well. But ultimately, let's get this bill to the president's desk and let him make a decision. Is he going to finally stand up for American workers and sign this bill? Or is it going to continue to support a law that's destroying jobs and destroying health care in this country? That ought to be the president's burden. We ought to send that bill to the president. This is the first step, and it's a critical step to restoring jobs and good health care across this country. Let's pass this bill, send it over to the Senate, and let them do their work. I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back. Gentleman from Texas reserves. The gentleman from Michigan.
Mr. Speaker, how much time on each side of the 15 minutes?
The gentleman from Michigan has 1 minute and a half. The gentleman from Texas has 2 minutes.
All right, we'll use our minute and a half. It's my real pleasure to yield our minute and a half to Mr. Rangel, a gentleman who has served this committee in this country so well.
The gentleman from New York is recognized for a minute and a half. Without objection.
I think this bill before us shows what's wrong with the Congress. I don't challenge the corrections that people on the Republican side would want to make in providing health care for our nation. It is a problem when none of them actually voted for the bill, but that could have been because we didn't give them access and opportunity. But it would seem to me, especially when we're trying to find out someone who will become Speaker of the House, that if you have objections to a bill that provides health services for Americans, that we would try to find out before we ask for a veto what we can do to help. There cannot be any Republican here that truly believes that we should eliminate preventive health care. Preventive health care is not only human and the right thing to do, but it saves us a lot of money. We have an advisory board that determines the amount of time that should be spent based on statistics. Yes, these are life or death questions, but it's also saving money as well as saving lives. There's so many objections that you may have as to how we use the tax system to encourage people and to mandate people that people pay in the system. Most of you know that if people can have insurance and not pay for it, everyone would want it. This is insurance. Yes, healthy people have to participate because younger people don't believe that they'll ever get sick. So don't just say that you want to make certain that the president vetoes this for political purposes so you can go back home and say, yes, one more shot against the president, one more shot against the Congress, and in some cases, one more shot against your own party. Let's, for God's sake, try to work together to try to get something positively done. I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back. Gentleman from Texas.
Mr. Speaker, to close on behalf of the American people, I yield 2 minutes to a distinguished gentleman from Louisiana, a physician, one of the leaders on health care, Dr. Boustany.
Gentleman from Louisiana is recognized for 2 minutes.
I thank the Speaker, and I thank my friend from Texas for yielding time. Mr. Speaker, I rise in support of this reconciliation package because it hits right at the financing of Obamacare. And as a physician, I know what the impact of this health law has done. It's devastating in causing serious disruptions in access to care, quality of care, and really eroding the doctor-patient relationship. Secondly, it puts a halt to the funding of Planned Parenthood. We all know, based on those videos and other information we've had on the practices of Planned Parenthood, it's time to stop it. As a pro-life physician, it's time to stop it. And finally, this forces the president to explain the support of these horrible failed policies. Conservatives across the spectrum are standing strong in support of this package, and that's because it contains important provisions, like one that I authored, repealing the employer mandate, which is hurting job creation in this country. An onerous provision, it's choking small business growth. I only wish we could have done more in this package, but we're limited by the Senate rules and the Senate parliamentarian. I would have liked full repeal of Obamacare. I would have liked to see the inclusion of my bill repealing the health insurance tax, which has been very costly, running up premium costs. We couldn't do that because of constraints. We will continue to fight these fights, but let's pass this package. It's really important. It will get job creation going. It will help roll back the onerous effects of Obamacare. If signed into law, there's no question in my mind that this reconciliation package will cause an implosion of Obamacare and force us to get to real health care reform based on high quality and a high quality doctor-patient relationship built on trust. At the very least, we will accomplish putting this on the president's desk and have him account for his failed policies. He will have to account for the policies that kill jobs, adding mountains of debt to this country, and continuing a legacy of failed policy. Support this package. It's a very important step. And with that, I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back.
Mr. Speaker, could I ask unanimous consent that the gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Pallone, be allowed to control the next 15 minutes of debate?
Without objection. Gentleman from Georgia.
I'm pleased to yield to the chairman of the Energy and Commerce Committee, Mr. Upton, to control 15 minutes as my designee.
Without objection, the gentleman from Michigan is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would yield myself such time as I may consume.
The gentleman is recognized.
So, Mr. Chairman, today I rise in support of this important